Okay, and our next speaker is Daniel Cherubino, talking about first light simulations of primeval galaxies. Take it away.
Thank you. So yes, this is a project I'm leading in the University of Heidelberg in collaboration with Ralph Klessen, Simon Glover, and Eric Peregrini. We're going to focus on the properties of the primeval galaxies from the epoch of ionization, so somewhere in redshift 6 and redshift 12. Our main tools are cosmological simulation of galaxy formation. So I don't need to introduce much topic. Just want to add one comment that I think Martin already mentioned. So we plot the current simulations of galaxy formation around the epoch of ionization in this diagram. Here I'm plotting the dark matter particle mass as a function of a box size. This PV, Renaissance, and CUDA, you can see a nice trend. So if people want to simulate a large volume, they need to use a very low resolution. Otherwise, the simulation is very expensive. But we need this high, this large volume and also high resolution. So first, we need large volume because we like to have a large sample of simulated galaxies to make a good statistics. And at the same time, the number densities of observed galaxies at high redshift are very low. So we need relatively large volumes. And at the same time, we like to resolve the ISN of these galaxies to get the intrinsic properties. So we need very high resolution. So we like to have simulations in this corner. Large volumes and high resolution. So that's the regime of the first light project. Okay, that's one of the things we're going to check. The simulation against is the Ubino luminosity function, for example, redshift 8. This is the observed sample here. Notice that the number densities are very low. So if we want to have a simulation in this regime, we need relatively large volumes. Also, we do make predictions of the slope of the luminosity function. This is this Loma slope, but it's very important for randomizations. And again, we are going to see if we see a break in the luminosity function, again, a flattening. Also, very interesting. So again, this any simulation should be able to reproduce these three main properties and the right correlation between these three properties: the halo mass, the stellar mass of the central galaxy, and the UV magnitude or the star formation rate of the galaxy. We are going to check simulation against these observables, the UV luminosity function, but also the stellar mass function. So the first light project is a sample of like 1,000 assuming cosmological simulations. So we are going to take different cosmological volume and do a mass selected sample. We select all the halos with a mass between 10 to 9 and 10 to 11 stellar masses. So we have different independent assuming regions. We are running them with a resolution of 10 parsecs. Very high resolution, but at the same time, a large sample. So this is the largest database for some simulations with this kind of resolution. The simulations are done with the R code, includes all the standard physics, cooling, star formation. In particular, we have different models of feedback. We are including thermal feedback, gravity feedback from massive stars, but also kinetic feedback. So this is just a sample. This is the gas distribution of this one of the zoomings. This is the large scale structure. We see complicated web of filaments. The galaxies are forming in those filaments in high density regions. For example, you see the formation of the first galaxy here in red, blue means very high densities. You can see after the first burst of star formation, most of the ISN of this galaxy is gone. It's being ejected by a strong burst and a strong feedback. This galaxy is living in a low mass potential, a low mass halo. So the potential was very shallow. Later on, we will see the formation of another galaxy here. Now this galaxy is living in a more massive halo. The potential is deeper. The galaxy is able to retain most of the ISM. Figure of the ISM looks a bit clumpy, but it's able to generate stars with like semi-continuously. So yes, this is gas density. So you see a lot of outflows here and there. So the star formation rate is set by very complex interplay between two processes. Here you have a strong inflow from the stream, but also there are outflows. So you see this interplay is very complex because the streams see that well resolved, that many small halos within the stream that contribute to feedback. So the streams are also very clumpy. Also, the outflow looks very clumpy because there are different phases within the outflow. There's a very complicated process. So we are assuming simulations resolve the ASM of the central galaxy as well as the large scale structure. That's the we have now many simulations of this kind. This is just one example. So this we took the first few simulations and we are plotting here the UV luminosity function. These are the best light tests, the red points. So here for each simulation, we measured the star formation rate. It was a proxy of the UV magnitude, and the maximum circular velocity gave us a proxy of the number density. So these are the points, and the solid line is the observation, the fit of the observation. See very good agreement, especially at high luminosities. And now we go to low luminosity, we see a flattening. The flattening of the luminosity function happens below a magnitude minus 13, a very faint object. But we are trying to understand this it's flattening in the following way. So again, this plot, the bottom axis is the star formation rate, and the y-axis is the halo mass. This point, so this plot is telling us that below a given halo mass, or below a given maximum circular velocity, galaxies are moving to the right. Galaxies are moving to regions with lower star formation rate. We mean that feedback is able to prevent or quench the star formation in these galaxies, or at least it's making the star formation very inefficient in this halo. That's why they are moving this way. So we found a flattening driven by feedback in halos within the circular velocity between 30 and 40 km per second. Those are relatively high circular velocity. For example, a photo evaporation feedback will not do much in this mass scale. So they are, this is really the effect of stellar feedback. We see a strong evolution of the luminosity function. Now we're going to regime 8. We got agreement with observations in this regime here. And we go to the 15. We see a strong evolution of the alpha parameter of the slope of this relation. The slope is like minus 2.6, a very high alpha parameter at regime 10. So it means that these faint galaxies make a strong contribution at the beginning of randomization. So this should be taken into account. Also, we can look at the scaling relations. These are plotting the stellar mass versus the UV magnitude, comparing with observations. So the red contours are the Song et al. Observations. So you see that the simulations can continue the observed relation to much lower stellar masses. We found very good agreement there. Now we're looking at the viral mass over the UV magnitude, and we can compare with other simulations. For example, the Filanto result or the Liu et al., those are the dashed lines. For high masses and high luminosities, we find very good agreement, but they start to deviate at low luminosity or low masses. Again, because they are, for the same halo mass, they have much higher star formation rate because they are using very different feedback. In their model, the feedback is not strong enough to regulate the star formation at the low mass end. That's why they're having too many stars at those regions. That's a typical problem with simulations. And that translates in the stellar halo mass relation. So we do see evolution in this relation, but the evolution is roughly a factor of 3. So you need to have really a very good handle of the scatter to see this kind of evolution. So I'm plotting here the stellar mass versus the viral mass at two different redshifts, redshift 6 in red and redshift 10 in blue. So the contours are the result from abundance matching, the Belusian silk 2016. And we found very good agreement with the simulation. It's a factor of 3 increase in the normalization going from redshift 6 to redshift 10. But also the slope is a bit higher. Therefore, at the low mass end, they're basically indistinguishable. We don't see evolution at the low mass end. The strong evolution happens for relatively more massive halo, like 10 to the 10 or 10 to the 10.5, that's all the mass. So we can also look at the stellar mass functions, and we found very good agreement with observations, both with the Song et al. And the Duncan results, those are the blue and the red contours, that give you a constraint in the using the restrain UV. Also, we are consistent with the observation in the restrain visible. This point is from Stefanon 2016. So overall, they're good agreement. We don't see a flattening here of the stellar mass function, very steep. So now we can go a step further and study the details, the properties of these galaxies, in particular the star formation history. Here I just brought in three examples. We have now many of those, but this gives you just an idea of that these galaxies essentially are all very bursty. They have a strong burst, like this one or this one. They're very common because this redshift, the universe is very violent. You see a lot of gas inflow. So the evolution, so the specific star formation rate of time, you see the jump by a factor of 5, relatively short period of time here. So they should be taken into account at any modeling of this galaxy. So the star formation rate is not constant or even increasing. That really making these jumps, relatively short time scale. That's important if we want to do the modeling of the stellar spectra. So this is for one of the galaxies. This is the stellar spectra, the spectrum, the black line. It's a combination of more than 300 single star populations. We are using the star brand 9 burst to get this black line. So the black line can be decomposed into main populations. So these are populations that don't dominate the non-ionizing region of the spectrum. It's dominated by population with few hundred million years old. But the most interesting part, that this part is the ionizing part of the spectra, is dominated by extremely young population, with the age of only a few million years. We see that the star formation history is very clumpy. So this the amount of ionizing flux is going to jump a lot. It's going to fluctuate in a relatively short period of time. This should be also taken into account. But now we can do some more observations. We can take the initial spectra from a stellar population and along a given line of sight. We are going to use Claudy to get the spectrum at any given cloud. So you can see that this spectrum in the far UV, this is the ionizing part of the spectrum is being absorbed. And we can also get the emission lines in the, for example, we can get H alpha and make a prediction that things that James Webb is going to see, which is going to be very strong H alpha emission line, nebula line. Finally, we're also making the UV image. So this is the red spring UV image, just one example. And we are going to compile all these examples, we are going to make more statistics in the near future. But this is just an example. This is the galaxy with a magnitude in the UV of minus 17, so relatively massive bright object, a redshift 6, that's something that can be observed now. So, but this galaxy, you see, is very clumpy, but the half-life radius is only 1 kiloparsec. And this is a relatively big galaxy. So these galaxies, high redshift, are small. So just my summary. So this first light project aims to study the formation of the first galaxies that drive ionization. The UV luminosity function and the stellar mass function are in agreement with observed or extrapolated function, redshift 6 or 10. We see a flattening of the luminosity function due to feedback and a strong evolution of the slope, the alpha slope, so it could be as high as minus 2.5 at redshift 10. And the basic relation between halo mass, stellar mass, and UV magnitude are consistent with the current data. And finally, these first galaxies are all bursting and small.
Time for some questions.
I have a comment both for you and the previous talk that we had. I tried to fit the data. But we heard from Richard Bauer and others that the data is totally uncertain. Richard said it is zero. So I would suggest and encourage data to try to come up with strict predictions.
Yeah, we're making predictions. No. I'm not tuning. Great. Yes, first point, I'm not tuning anything. So I'm just checking the bright end of the luminosity function. That's what, something that I will constrain. And the predictions are coming in the low mass end. Of the low luminosity end, those are going to be the prediction at high level.
Martin.
Yes. Yes, that's right.
Okay, let's thank Daniel again. And our last speaker for the session is Kameswara Mamp.